It's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Jody Gangloff-Kaufmann, and she is the coordinator of the Community IPM program at New York State IPM. And today she'll be talking to us about how to avoid getting and spreading bed bugs. This is a very timely topic for anyone that is traveling this holiday season, or if you are hosting anybody during the holiday season, this is extremely relevant. So without any further ado, Jody, you can take it away.
Thank you, Matt, and thanks everybody for being here today. How to avoid getting and spreading bed bugs. This has been a topic that I've worked with for about 20 years now. So we're about, you know, a little over 20 years into bed bug problems in the United States. So let's just get to it. Are you gonna work? Yeah. So we're not gonna talk about the biology of bed bugs today because, you know, that stuff's been talked about, but I'm going to talk about the people part of this. How does a person even get bed bugs? A lot of people turn around and say, I don't know where I picked it up. I don't know how I got it. So part of avoiding getting and spreading them is knowing how you got them, right? So here I have the ultimate guide to getting bed bugs. And doesn't that couch look appealing? You just want to take that home. You know, that's a leather couch right there. So the ultimate guide. I want you to be sure to grab that perfectly good lazy boy out of the garbage or on the curb, especially while it's raining. It's going to be a little cleaner because used furniture is an excellent source of bed bugs. And if you really want bed bugs, you might give couch surfing a try because people can be really generous and unaware or clueless about, you know, the things they share with you. Couch surfing is a terrific way to get bed bugs. Definitely do not check your children's stuff when they come home from college or camp if you're really interested in having bed bugs, because kids love bringing guests home for the holidays, and bed bugs are pretty common in college dorms and camp. And remember, there is no need to check that hotel mattress if you're interested in getting bed bugs. Even better, leave your luggage open for easier access so bed bugs can crawl right inside. So, you know, all joking aside, we need a change in mindset if we are to avoid, you know, getting bed bugs. Bed bugs are not everywhere you look, not everywhere in our world, but they could be anywhere. And the most common places you'll find them are places you'd expect: homes and hotels, transportation, even a movie theater or a lobby or a waiting room, and libraries. And what do these things have in common? These are places where people spend time sitting, resting, or sleeping. And that means that bed bugs can grab a bite, they can feed, you know, secretly or or voraciously if, you know, we're talking about a home or a nursing home, and they can set up shop and become infestations. So any public space could have bed bugs, but most do not. And you want to protect yourself by knowing the signs of bed bugs when you are out and about, especially traveling. So knowing the signs of bed bugs. The first thing you probably would see is a fecal stain, because sometimes they're just hard to get rid of and they're hard to wash off. So this is fecal stains, which is digested blood, you know, comes out the other end. These have soaked into the wood, and that's what happens in wood and fabric. The stains kind of soak in. That is a couple of stains next to the edge of a dime, just for size reference. They're tiny. It's like you touched a pen or a magic marker to whatever surface. Here are some fecal stains that look more like raised bumps. I always think of candy buttons, which is gross, but fecal stains can be black and they can also be tan, because blood has various components that are nutritious to bed bugs. But so they may be raised bumps. And then fecal stains also bleed off when you clean them. So if you take a wet cloth to a spot and it comes off in a rusty color, that suggests you're dealing with a fecal stain there, and that's a reason to look for bed bugs. You might see shed skins. Now, you're not going to see them in this number because this was a terrible infestation, but if I were to blow that, they would just scatter like dust. So tiny little shells of bed bugs are one of the signs, and the more you see, the more you know that problem's been going on. You might see eggs. It might be the last thing you'd find, but eggs are visible to the naked eye, and you can see these eggs have a little opening, a little hole. That's where the baby bed bug crawled out and essentially hatched out of the egg. Eggs are very visible if you have an LED light, like a little flashlight. You can see them. They kind of luminesce, you know. And if the lid is not there, that opening is not there, then the egg might be viable. These mostly are unviable eggs. They're just the shells of the eggs. And then, of course, live and dead bed bugs are the ultimate sign of a bed bug infestation. And like I said, you probably would see fecal stains first. But why not this? Why not? These could be anything. The problem with trying to diagnose bed bugs from bites is that people vary in their reaction to bites. So bites and stings and allergies and dermal reactions can all look the same or different depending on the person and their level of sensitivity to such things. Now, I know for a fact that these are bed bug bites and they are pretty typical bed bug bites, but they could be mosquito bites and they could potentially even be flea bites. So we do not use bites to diagnose bed bugs. But if you saw this, if this is what happened to you when you're traveling, you would definitely have reason to start looking for bed bugs and taking the precautions. Understanding the risk when you are out and about is really important. And there's a big difference between bed bug introduction and infestation. Introductions can happen anywhere there are people. And when people, you know, move about and bring gear or bags or something, bed bugs can fall off their clothing or their possessions. Bed bugs don't like to be transported around, and they're likely to fall off because they don't like that kind of movement, but they do get stuck in bags and coats and shoes and things like that. So what we end up with is transfer points, places where bed bugs are exchanged. And a good example of that is a coat check. And so if you put your coat into a coat check and someone else has bed bugs at home, didn't take any precautions, you can have a bed bug exchange in that setting. And there's a big reason I don't use coat checks anymore. But an infestation of bed bugs can happen really only in places where bed bugs can find shelter, comfortable temperature and humidity, which is basically what we find comfortable in temperature and humidity, and reliable hosts. So what's a reliable host? It's an area that's used for rest and used repeatedly, once a day, once a week, maybe even once a month. A reliable host is simply having a host in the same spot where bed bugs have set up in a shelter, in a place that's comfy for them. And so those are the elements you need to have a bed bug infestation. And that can't happen in a lot of places. So the chances of encountering bed bugs are lower in places like schools and offices. Although bed bugs show up in these places, they don't get the opportunity generally to start infestations because they don't have all those elements. People don't sit still, they don't rest. A shopping mall, supermarket, restaurant, those kind of things. But if you get into this higher risk category, which is different than homes, doctor's office, it's very intimate, you're taking off potentially your clothes and things like that, or child and elder daycare, that's where people may rest and sleep. Kids, of course, sleep at childcare. And those are very vulnerable places. Community centers in New York City, there are cooling centers in the summertime. They tend to be places where bed bugs can become more common. And then a gym or a fitness center or laundry has to do with the things you bring there, your bags and your gear and stuff. So a little bit higher risk in those locations versus places where we don't settle down. Now, high risk jobs are also a concern, both for the person working and the person who's getting that work done. So think about the cable guy who comes into a home, or think about a home healthcare aide and the person who is receiving care. Both of those set of people or entities are at risk. So the high risk job is that person has a high risk of bringing bed bugs home. They also have a high risk of transferring bed bugs from place to place. So it's good to, if you are in a high risk job, to be very aware and take the precautions. Here are some tips. I can't go into very deep detail, but we have some tips to travel without bed bugs. First of all, you should be carrying the New York City IPM Bedbug Traveler's Card. This is a four-sided folding wallet-sized card, and that's why half of that is upside down, it folds over. And it shows you what everything looks like. It tells you how to inspect things that, you know, your bed and things like that. And it's good leverage if you do find evidence of bedbugs in a hotel room. You can go to the front desk and say, I know what I'm talking about. I have seen a bedbug. Give me a new room, please. Always carry a bright LED flashlight for your hotel room inspection. They come in a very tiny sizes these days. So there's no reason not to carry a little flashlight. You might keep your clothing and toiletries in sealed bags inside suitcases just to prevent any kind of exposure from the room to your belongings. You would store luggage at home when you're traveling a lot. Keep that luggage when it comes home away from living areas or inside airtight bags. You don't want that luggage to go under your bed in your bedroom. And also check recent online reviews of hotels for reports of bed bugs. You often find either the good, there was a situation, they took care of it, or you can find the bad, you know, like neglectful situations with bed bugs. So I always check hotels for their bed bug reports and like Travelocity and things like that. Tips to reduce the risk in a hotel. This is what we recommend is when you enter the hotel, leave your luggage near the door in the bathroom, take off your coat and anything extra, and go and check all sides of the mattress and the box spring, especially under the linens and under that bed skirt and all along the sides. And if you can, lift the edge of the mattress or, you know, lift it a little bit higher and look underneath between the mattress and the box spring for any signs of bed bugs. Headboards tend to be removable from walls, but we don't recommend it because they tend to be very big. So a trick is to use a hot hair dryer and point that air underneath or behind the headboard and see what crawls out the other side, if anything. So that's a way to flush bed bugs from behind the headboard. If you find them, get a new room. Check your nightstand for evidence of bed bugs. You might find fecal stains there. Again, with the headboard, you might find fecal stains around the edge if it's well mounted. So keep your eye on that. And then inspect your bed after sleeping there for one night. If you get up and you look at the bed and you see anything like a blood spot, you might want to take a closer look and make sure that you are not being exposed to bed bugs because the bites may not manifest on your skin for days. Okay, so donations and secondhand things are another way that bed bugs make their way around our communities. Used furniture, it's pretty straightforward. You would want to do a thorough inspection of anything that you buy or that you bring home, especially if you're getting it from someone directly from their home. You know, ask questions, has this been exposed to bed bugs or any other pests, truthfully? And any mattresses or box springs that are acquired secondhand should absolutely be encased in bed bug safe covers. Those are available for about $50 to $75, and they are worth the money. With used clothing, it's simple. Place everything that you have in a hot dryer. Don't wash it. Just dry it on high for 20 to 30 minutes. And we have a lot of recommendations for household items. This is all the stuff the exterminator will not do. So how to get bed bugs out of your belongings, that QR code, if you have a smartphone right now, you can look at this QR code through your camera and go right to that website. This is a 75-page guide on everything in your house that might have become exposed to bedbugs, including things like musical instruments and appliances. So that link will also be in the chat. Using the washer and dryer. Well, this is really just the dryer. When worried about bedbug exposure, think about heat. Heat is probably our best tool to eliminate bedbugs, to kill them. So you can dry anything exposed that can go in a dryer, even pillows and blankets and stuff, but clothing, even soft shoes, not high heel boots or anything, but you know, sneakers, they can go in the dryer on high for 20 to 30 minutes. And all you need is a dryer that gets to 125 degrees that will kill the eggs and the adults. How do you know that your dryer is hot enough? Well, this technique seemed to work for us. I took three dry clean towels and threw them in the dryer, set the dryer to what I wanted to measure. After 20 minutes of drying, I opened the dryer and I threw in a meat thermometer in the middle of those towels and I closed it quickly. Don't let the heat escape. And after about 5 minutes, I opened it up and checked the temperature. Very simple. A meat thermometer is what you need because it gets to cooking temperatures. And as long as you can achieve 125 degrees, you're good. You're good for sanitizing and decontaminating anything in your clothing. Even wool coats can go in there if they're dry. A hair dryer on high provides more intense heat, as much as 180 degrees, So this can be used to treat shoes that won't go in the dryer or luggage or other larger items. And we suggest that this technique is used in a bathtub or the shower without water. Don't add water here because we don't want people being electrocuted. But in a dry bathroom, bathtub or shower, that will prevent you from blowing bed bugs off of whatever you're treating into your home. It will contain them and it will be easy to flush them right down the drain if necessary. So this is a very good technique. We have more information about this in that publication I mentioned on how to do it. Isolation of belongings is really helpful. A storage bin with lid pictured there is something that you could use in an office where there might be a high risk situation. You don't want to bring bed bugs home or any other pests, cockroaches. Keep your stuff in a storage bin that's closed with a lid, or keep things in an extra large Ziploc bag. They make them big enough to fit comforters now. So these things will protect any belongings you have whenever you're in a high risk situation. When arriving home after a possible exposure, you definitely want to inspect your clothing for bed bugs. And here are some tips. Only adult females can start infestations by themselves, and they are pretty visible. They're pretty large, the size of a lentil, and they move about. So, and they can't really get into crevices of the clothing that easily. The eggs, on the other hand, are not likely to be picked up because they're cemented in place. You don't have to worry about that. And even a single nymph may bite you several times if you bring one home, but they cannot reproduce by themselves. So when we looked at the number of bed bugs that were introduced to New York City schools, we found that 60% were adult females. So that's bad on one hand, they are ready to spread new infestations, but good on the other hand, because they are visible. So inspect your clothing. Create a safety zone at home. The safety zone is a place where potentially bed bug exposed things can be isolated to prevent introduction. You wanna set aside a place, a garage, a bathroom, a hallway, somewhere that you can use for decontamination using a light colored. I'll show you what I mean in the next slide. Have clean clothes handy. On the other hand, if you have bed bugs in your home and you need to leave and you don't wanna bring them, create a bed bug free zone where you keep things that are decontaminated. Clothing and gear and stuff that's kept away from any bed bug, activity, so that you can take those things when you leave. So back to the safety zone. This is me standing on a white sheet that I've rolled inward and created sort of a dish that I'm standing in. I can take my clothes off, drop them all in the middle of this sheet. Any bed bugs on my clothing will run, if they fall off, will run under the edges of that sheet. I can roll that whole thing up, wrapping the clothes and shoes into a packet and toss it right into the dryer and minimize any chance of getting bed bugs inside my home. So techniques like that are also, I think, explained in publications we have online. So here are 13 picture guides. This is one of them. For bedbug self-help at the New York State IPM program, both in Spanish and English. This is the work of Dr. Matt Frye. And they are minimal words and lots of visuals here, so hopefully understandable to a wide range of people. And every step of bedbug self-help is presented in these. Okay. We also have this personal safety protocol. We haven't put this online yet, but it's literally tips to avoid getting and spreading bedbugs. So if you want a copy of this, please ask, and we'd be happy to share. So our take-home messages today, we're all responsible for not moving bedbugs around our communities, just like we're responsible for not spreading flu or even COVID now. you want to know what bedbugs look like and what the signs of them look like, and you want to know which items, which places, and which situations have the kind of risks we worry about. Taking common sense steps to isolate when we've been exposed is absolutely recommended, and use these tips to avoid getting and spreading bed bugs. We have a lot more information online, so come to our website and see it. Oh, wait, look at that. That looks like a nice Natuzzi couch, right? Here's a pro tip. Nice things that are left on the curb are probably, they're more likely to be infested with bed bugs. Probably, we think. So there's a lot of nice furniture out in the streets of New York City. Don't touch it. Don't go there. And a big thank you to Matt Frye and Amara Dunn for organizing the 2021 season of What's Bugging You First Fridays. Thanks everybody for tuning in. And Matt Frye has some tips on clothing moth for you. Thanks.
Thank you, Jody. Great presentation as always. And again, very seasonally relevant and some great tips that people can keep in mind, not only for eliminating bed bugs, but also for preventing introductions and encounters with bed bugs. So thank you. I think what we'll do at this point is transition to the IPM minute. And then if we have time, we will perhaps address some questions that did come in the chat. So I'm going to share my screen. And for today's IPM Minute, we'll be talking about identifying sources of clothes moths. We thought that this topic would be relevant at this time of year because now people are spending a lot of time indoors and they may see a moth flying around and try and figure out where they're coming from and how best to manage them. So I wanted to first start with the ecological perspective on these critters. They are natural organisms that are occurring outdoors around our environments all the time. And the typical setting that they are living in and performing ecological functions is when an animal dies. So here we have an example, you know, a deer encounter on a highway, that animal dies. There's a lot of organisms that come in and break down the body and especially the internal components. But once the carcass is dry, that's when these critters come in. So we have our clothing moth, our beetles of a wide variety that break down the keratin that's found in some of these dry parts like hair. And they eventually return this to soil. So all part of the circle of life, except when it comes into your home. So from the pest management perspective, these guys are feeding on keratin containing products. And this includes things like animal hides, hairs, feathers, horns. So products that we have indoors like silk, leather, and wool are all animal based and all target feeding for these critters. In the case of clothing moths, they bite off fibers, they chew on the stump, and then they move on. So what we see is like a trail of damaged fibers. And this is often found in places that are dark and protected, such as under furniture, when clothing is found in closets, particularly underneath collars and the folds of cuffs. So they want to be protected and they want to be in a dark location. Some things are not clothing moths that we find and people are very upset about. So if the clothing item in question is something that is composed of plant fibers like cotton or synthetic fibers, is often a manufacturing defect, a snag on a buckle or a belt that is causing the tiny hole. And there's the picture on the right is a reference to a blog post that has thousands of comments of people that have a hole right above their belly button. And it's from leaning up against a counter while doing food prep, and that's creating a hole from wear and tear against a buckle of jeans. So there's a number of causes that are not clothing moths. So just finding a hole in clothes does not mean that you're dealing with that particular pest. The one caveat for materials that are plant-based like cotton is if it's heavily soiled. So in instances when a t-shirt, for example, is your favorite gym t-shirt, you wear it all the time, the armpits are heavily stained with oil secretions, that may be attractive to clothing moths feeding. So they would consume that and leave holes in that item. So there are instances, but it's very rare that plant-based materials are chewed by these pests. The main ways that we identify the pest is through their evidence. So that could be the chewing of particular fibers. You see in this picture on the right, the webbing and feces that are left behind from the webbing clothes moth. In rare cases, you may actually see the larva, which is this cream-colored insect on the upper left, and they have a reddish or blackish head capsule. But most times they're really hard to see because they have these feeding tubes that are composed of the fibers of the food material that they're eating. So they blend in really well, avoiding detection. When people start to get concerned is when they see the adult moths flying around. And it's important to note that there are a number of moths that can be found indoors. A lot of them are pantry moths that are associated with food items. We had a previous presentation by Jody talking about those pantry moth pests. So the way that we differentiate these clothing moths is by these orange spiky hairs on top of their head on the adult moth, and then the fringe at the end of the wings. So that's one feature that can be used. In order to find where they are living, we want to conduct a detailed inspection. We want to think about those potential sources in the home, the animal-based fibers, whether it's a carpet that we have, a particular piece of clothing, a blanket. We want to really take a close look at those items and potentially, if they're not in use, perform some kind of treatment on them, whether it's dry cleaning or doing your own kind of cleaning to remove any moth evidence and then store them securely. We want to make sure that we're looking for pest evidence in those dark and undisturbed places that are particularly attractive to them, and consider some non-traditional sources. So I'll show a few pictures next about dead animal sources that are often contributing to clothing moth infestations indoors. One of the techniques that is really useful is monitoring, and there are a variety of pheromone traps available to attract the male moths to the lure. This is particularly informative for detection. It is not a management technique because it only attracts the males. And this picture, I should note, is an Indian meal moth trap, but it's the same concept of attracting males with a lure. There are some things to consider when it comes to monitoring is that these lures can attract other species. In this case, the tan moths are the target, but this brown dotted moth is something that lives outdoors and in bird nests and can be attracted to indoor areas when there's too much pheromone used. So here's the other sources. In, you know, buildings where people are managing rodents and then forget about them or they die in walls, the carcasses left behind can be a source for these moths to feed on. So it's certainly something to keep in mind when we're trying to identify sources. Again, some just real quick management information. Prevention is the key. We want to make sure that we're isolating items that are potential food sources for these pests, and keeping them away from any activity indoors. So that was your quick IPM minute on clothing moths. We did have a bunch of questions come in to the chat, and we will address those in our resources page on the website. I want to thank Jody again for a terrific presentation on bed bugs and how to avoid getting and spreading them. And we hope that you all have a happy and safe holiday season and hope to see you next year at our future First Frye events. So thank you.